The Lancashire Witches, A Romance of Pendle Forest, by William Harrison Ainsworth. Introduction. The Last Abbot of Whaley.
Chapter 9. Wiswall Hall. Shortly before 10 o'clock, a numerous cortege, consisting of a troop of horse in their full equipments, a band of archers with their bows over their shoulders, and a long train of barefoot monks, who had been permitted to attend, set out from the abbey. Behind them came a varlet with a paper mitre on his head and a leathern crozier in his hand, covered with a surcoat, on which was emblazoned, but torn and reversed, the arms of Paslew, argent, a fess between three mullets, sable, pierced of the field, a crescent for difference. After him came another varlet, bearing a banner, on which was painted a grotesque figure in a half-military, half-monastic garb, representing the Earl of Poverty, with this distich beneath it: "Priest and warrior, rich and poor, he shall be hanged at his own door." Next followed a tumbrel, drawn by two horses, in which sat the abbot alone, the other two prisoners being kept back for the present. Then came Demdike, in a leathern jerkin and a blood-red hose, fitting closely to his sinewy limbs, and wrapped in a houppeland of the same colour as the hose, with a coil of rope round his neck. He walked between two ill-favoured personages, habited in black, whom he had chosen as assistants. A band of halberdiers brought up the rear. The procession moved slowly along, the passing bell tolling each minute, and a muffled drum sounding hollowly at intervals. Shortly before the procession started, the rain ceased, but the air felt damp and chill, and the roads were inundated. Passing out at the northeastern gateway, the gloomy train skirted the south side of the convent church, and went on in the direction of the village of Whaley. When near the east end of the holy edifice, the abbot beheld two coffins borne along, and on inquiry learned that they contained the bodies of Bess Demdike and Cuthbert Ashbead, who were about to be interred in the cemetery. At this moment his eye for the first time encountered that of his implacable foe, and he then discovered that he was to serve as his executioner. At first Paslew felt much trouble at this thought, but the feeling quickly passed away. On reaching Whaley, every door was found closed, and every window shut, so that the spectacle was lost upon the inhabitants, and after a brief halt the cavalcade set out for Wiswall Hall. Sprung from an ancient family, residing in the neighbourhood of Whaley, Abbot Paslew was the second son of Francis Paslew of Wiswall Hall, a great gloomy stone mansion situated at the foot of the south-western side of Pendle Hill, where his brother Francis still resided. Of a cold and cautious character, Francis Paslew, second of the name, held aloof from the insurrection, and when his brother was arrested he wholly abandoned him. Still, the owner of Wiswall had not altogether escaped suspicion, and it was probably as much with the view of degrading him as of adding to the abbot's punishment that the latter was taken to the hall on the morning of his execution. Be this as it may, the cortege toiled thither through roads bad in the best of seasons, but now the rain scarcely passable, and it arrived there in about half an hour, and drew up on the broad green lawn. Window and door of the hall were closed, no smoke issued from the heavy pile of chimneys, and to all outward seeming the place was utterly deserted. In answer to inquiries, it appeared that Francis Paslew had departed for Northumberland on the previous day, taking all his household with him. In earlier years, a quarrel having occurred between the haughty abbot and the churlish Francis, the brothers rarely met, whence it chanced that John Paslew had seldom visited the place of his birth of late, though lying so near to the abbey, and indeed forming part of its ancient dependencies. It was sad to view it now, and yet the house, gloomy as it was, recalled seasons with which, though they might awaken regret, no guilty associations were connected. Dark was the hall and desolate, but on the fine old trees around it the rooks were settling, and their loud cawings pleased him and excited gentle emotions. For a few moments he grew young again, and forgot why he was there, fondly surveying the house, the terraced garden in which, as a boy, he had so often strayed, and the park beyond it, where he had chased the deer. His gaze rose to the cloudy heights of Pendle, springing immediately behind the mansion, and up which he had frequently climbed. The floodgates of memory were opened at once, and a whole tide of long-buried feelings rushed upon his heart. From this half-painful, half-pleasurable retrospect, he was aroused by the loud blast of a trumpet, thrice blown. A recapitulation of his offences, together with his sentence, was read by a herald, after which the reversed blazonry was fastened upon the door of the hall, just below a stone escutcheon on which was carved the arms of the family, while the paper mitre was torn and trampled underfoot, the leathern crozier broken in twain, and the scurril banner hacked in pieces. While this degrading act was performed, a man in a miller's white garb, with the hood drawn over his face, forced his way towards the tumbrel, and while the attention of the guard was otherwise engaged, whispered in Paslew's ear, "I'n failed in my schemes, Feyther Abbot, but rest assured I'n avenger. Demmed action I my Sheffield twittle in his heart before he's a day older." "The wizard has a charm against steel, my son, and indeed is proof against all weapons forged by men," replied Paslew, who recognised the voice of Hallo Nabs, and hoped by this assertion to divert him from his purpose. "Ah, say you so, Feyther Abbot," cried Hal. "Then I'll reach him with summat sacred," and he disappeared. At this moment word was given to return, and in half an hour the cavalcade arrived at the abbey in the same order as it had left it. Though the rain had ceased, heavy clouds still hung overhead, threatening another deluge, and the aspect of the abbey remained as gloomy as ever. The bell continued to toll, drums were beaten, and trumpets sounded from the outer and inner gateway, and from the three quadrangles. The cavalcade drew up in front of the great northern entrance, and its return being announced within, the two other captives were brought forth, each fastened upon a hurdle, harnessed to a stout horse. They looked dead already, so ghastly was the hue of their cheeks. The abbot's turn came next. Another hurdle was brought forward, and Demdike advanced to the tumbrel. But Paslew recoiled from his touch, and sprang to the ground unaided. He was then laid on his back upon the hurdle, and his hands and feet were bound fast with ropes to the twisted timbers. While this painful task was roughly performed by the wizard's two ill-favoured assistants, the crowd of rustics who looked on murmured and exhibited such strong tokens of displeasure that the guard thought it prudent to keep them off with their halberts. But when all was done, Demdike motioned to a man standing behind him to advance, and the person, who was wrapped in a russet cloak, complied, drew forth an infant, and held it in such a way that the abbot could see it. Paslew understood what it meant, but he uttered not a word. Demdike then knelt down beside him, as if ascertaining the security of the cords, and whispered in his ear, "Recall thy malediction, and my dagger shall save thee from this last indignity."
"Never," replied Paslew. "The curse is irrevocable, but I would not recall it if I could. As I have said, thy child shall be a witch, and the mother of witches, but all shall be swept off, all." "Hell's torment seize thee," cried the wizard furiously. "Nay, thou hast done thy worst to me," rejoined Paslew meekly. "Thou canst not harm me beyond the grave. Look to thyself, for even as thou speakest, thy child is taken from thee." And so it was. While Demdike knelt beside Paslew, a hand was put forth, and before the man who had custody of the infant could prevent it, his little charge was snatched from him. This the abbot saw, though the wizard perceived it not. The latter instantly sprang to his feet. "Where is the child?" he demanded of the fellow in the russet cloak.
"It was taken from me by yon tall man who is disappearing through the gateway,"
replied the other in great trepidation.
"Ha! He here!" exclaimed Demdike, regarding the dark figure with a look of despair. "It is gone from me for ever."
"Ay, for ever!" echoed the abbot solemnly. "But revenge is still left me. Revenge!" cried Demdike with an infuriated gesture. "Then glut thyself with it speedily," replied the abbot, "for thy time here is short. I care not if it be," replied Demdike. "I shall live long enough if I survive thee."
End of chapter 9.